No. Not right there. Right, that's it, right there.
I'm sorry. Welcome to Rethinking the City, and I bet that's been happening for the past, I would say, six and a half, almost 7 years. We are an organization, a group of people who have been putting this event on monthly, focused on dialogue about what's happening in our city, whether it's about transportation, affordable housing, redevelopment, art. I'm one of the hosts, Sarah Baudry. I'm going to introduce Jason Reynolds in a second, but I wanted to tell you about the space that we're in. This is Credo Conduit, associated with Credo the Coffee Shop, but this is a co-working space. We are a place where meaning, impact, and community can happen, and we believe your work is better when you come alongside other folks that really believe in community. So there's a bunch of different things that are happening here. If you notice a movie truck outside, it's because we have a new tenant moving in. It's actually the League of Women Voters for the state of Florida. We have creative agencies here. We have political campaigns. We have development firms. I'm an urban planner, and I also have an office here. So if you know of anyone, or you yourself are seeking office space, or a space for a community event, or a conference room, we're available for that. If you want to learn more, we have credoconduit.com. If you step into the coffee shop and ask somebody, they should be able to tell you, and I'm here for questions. So just some housekeeping stuff. If you're looking for a bathroom, out front and around the curved wall, men's and women's bathrooms, and then there's a single stall in the back towards the left. I think that's it. So now I'm going to introduce Jason Reynolds, who is one of, who are all the hosts of Rethinking in the City that are here today? Awesome. So we have Eliza Harris in the back, Julian Chambliss, who, oh my God, is this your last Rethinking in the City?
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jason Reynolds. While I see the camera, I just want to announce everyone we are live streaming through Facebook, so if you do not want to be seen, or if you're concerned about your question, stand off camera or ask someone to ask your questions. This evening we're going to be hearing from Michelle Owens and Jeff Reine. Jeff Reine works for LYNX. Michelle Owens is the executive director of the Pine Hills Neighborhood Improvement District. Pine Hills is just west of here. I don't want to speak too much about what Michelle has to say because she'll say it much better than I will, and I don't want to steal their thunder. So without further ado, I want to bring up Michelle Owens to give the talk, Pine Hills, the Next Frontier.
Everyone for being here and being interested in Pine Hills. How many people have actually been through Pine Hills lately? Awesome. What do you, if you don't mind, just shout out a couple of things that you have heard or that you know about Pine Hills.
Diverse.
Thank you.
On the move, on the rise.
Lively.
Vibrant. Vibrant. Anybody over here have any adjectives that you want to throw out or anything you've heard about Pine Hills?
Commercial.
Commercial?
Yes, commercial. Very commercial.
Yes, some parts of it are. Right, absolutely. So Pine Hills is very vibrant, very diverse, and it's also probably one of the best kept secrets in Orlando in terms of investment. Where, you know, where's the next great thing for people who are interested in investing in, I don't know, real estate or you know, commercial businesses, or even, you know, starting your own, you know, entrepreneurship effort. Pine Hills is a great location, but not a lot of people realize that. For the, you know, last few years, we've been battling misinformation and wrong stories being incorrectly labeled other parts of town when bad things happen. So we've been gradually trying to get the word out that Pine Hills really is the next frontier in terms of where people may want to go to, you know, invest or move or become a part of the community. And so that's why we say that Pine Hills is the next frontier. So let's see here. I am going to just tell you right up front that I'm as far away from a type A personality as you can get. So I'm type Z, so this is going to be really laid back. Can you guys see this okay? I will tell you that Pine Hills is the next frontier because of so many different factors. When you think of a neighborhood, you know, sometimes you say, oh, that neighborhood has good bones, and it's a great place. You know, we're trying to revitalize it, and we're building on those great bones. I'm going to spend the next several minutes telling you why it's great bones, and we have Jeff Reine here from LYNX because they are a key factor in a lot of the revitalization that's going on in the Pine Hills area. So Pine Hills is the next frontier. Why is Pine Hills the next frontier? Well, once upon a time, in a galaxy not so far, Pine Hills was the superstar neighborhood in the 50s. It was designed literally for rocket scientists. People who worked at Martin Marietta, which became Lockheed Martin, built their homes here. State of the art. I'm sorry. I'm watching you guys. I told you I was quite busy. So in the 1960s and 70s, this was like the superstar suburb. They had a country club, and they had golf course, and they had a swimming pool. And this was the place that anybody that was, a white collar engineer from Lockheed, this is where they went. It was these rocket scientists. This was where they went to live. In the 1980s and 90s, that glory started to fade. We had what we now like to term white flight, people moving to the suburbs. There was economic disinvestment, the housing stock was getting older, people were moving to the newer, bigger, stucco homes on the fringes of downtown. And by the early 2000s, you might say that Pine Hills was a galactic failure. The crime rate was rising, people were moving out, the housing stock was in even worse repair. But then something happened. People started moving back, and it was lots of different types of people. People from Asia, people who never left, some of the original residents that still, homesteaded there. We saw people from the Caribbean. And during the late 2000s, the neighborhood began to get popular again because people were rediscovering how great it is. And why is it so great? Well, this is some pictures that you can see. We Pine Hills had a drive-in, churches, community events, shopping. So it was really the place to be. It's a census designated place, so it has defined boundaries. It's approximately 12.25 square miles, and it's just 3 miles west of downtown, and it literally is the geographic heart of Orange County. It's unincorporated. There's no city taxes for the residents that live there. They have two representatives on the Board of County Commissioners. It encompasses districts 2 and 6. It's very close to Ocoee, Winter Garden, College Park, and Metro West. In addition, it's got a very good road network, lots of connectivity through Pine Hills. 4 major roads, State Road 408, West Colonial, Pine Hills, and Silver Star. So when you think about a neighborhood that has good bones, or a place you want to invest, it's always location, 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 and Pine Hills has that, can put the check mark in that box, because it is a prime location. And we often say that if you want to have a sure shot, go for an area that has good bones. Pine Hills has 3 really busy commercial corridors, and it encompasses 2 zip codes. So if you can see, Silver Star Road, Pine Hills Road, and West Colonial are very busy commercial corridors. Pine Hills Road used to largely be residential, but many of those buildings are now able to convert their zoning to professional office. So we have lots of older homes, a lot of the little mid-century modern concrete blocks that people have converted into shops and daycares and attorney's offices, medical offices. So that little corridor is a lot of professional office. West Colonial and Silver Star, more so you'll see your shopping centers and some of your big box office shopping complexes. So we have 3 busy commercial corridors. That's another one of those good bones that we have in this area. Oops, it crashed. Oops. Residents in that 12.25 square mile area. So we often say that if Pine Hills were to incorporate, it would be the second largest city in Orange County after the city of Orlando. That's a lot of density and diversity. They also have a very young population. As you can see, the median age is 36. Lots of people own their homes. 61% of the housing there is over-occupied. And as you can see, in terms of diversity, like we said, you know, we have just a lot of African-Americans, we have people from the Caribbean, from Asia, we have original residents. So there's a lot of diversity and density, more of those good bones that we talk about in those areas that might be ripe for, you know, revitalization. We could be our own city, and we'd be a very diverse, very relatively young city. So we also have a lot of amenities in that area, so awesome amenities, another good bone. Barnett Park is a huge green space. It has a BMX bike trail. How many people do that? We have a BMX bike trail in Orange County. We also have a frisbee golf course there, we have a boat launch there, and it's just a beautiful green space that's open to the public. It's right near the Central Florida Fairgrounds, which is another one of our amenities there. We have the Pine Hills Community Center, which is an Orange County facility. And we also just got approved, thanks to the efforts of our District 6 Commissioner, Commissioner Sibley, a Pine Hills Cultural Center that will be making it a great adaptive reuse project in an old shopping center. So we'll hopefully see that come online in about the next 2 years. Pine Hills has a multi-use trail that was just completed earlier this year. It's a three-phase trail. We just finished phase one of this bike and walking trail. You see some kids already using it. And that trail is going to connect to Florida's coast-to-coast trail also. So this is a trail that you'll be able to travel all along the coast of Florida, and it will pass through Pine Hills. We also have Evans High School, which has won national awards for being a community school model, which basically means the kids that go to Evans get wraparound care. Everything from dental, counseling, medical, they get food, anything they need, they can get it at school. So we have awesome amenities in Pine Hills. You can see this is Barnett Park. This whole, all of this green space is Barnett Park, and it backs up to a lake, so you can see what a, you know, great amenity that is for the community. You can see pictures of the BMX bike trail, the boat launch, the basketball courts. We also have quirky landmarks. What neighborhood isn't complete without its quirky landmarks? So we have the Haunted Sunland Mental Hospital site. And this hospital site is written about in Florida's Ghostly Legends and Haunted Folklore. I have a copy of it over here if you want to read it. It is a really creepy story. And we have our own very well-known haunted hospital. We have a Chinatown gateway. When this was opened, when this was built in 2013, it was only the eighth gateway in the U.S. Even New York Chinatown didn't have a gateway. You can see what some of these other ones look like in Los Angeles, D.C., Philadelphia, Chicago. Ours ranks up there. And it's only the eighth one in the U.S. So we have a quirky landmark. And we have what lots of other neighborhoods. No other neighborhood in Orlando can claim the Elvis connection. We do have in Pine Hills a complete replica of Graceland built by a huge Elvis fan. So you can see Graceland in Memphis, Tennessee, and you can see Graceland in Pine Hills. So quirky landmarks. And we also have affordable mid-century modern housing, lots of it. And this graphic just shows that all these houses look alike. Pine Hills, College Park, Colonial Town, but the prices are vastly different. These are all in the 800 to 900 square foot range. You can pick up those houses in Pine Hills for $85,000 to $100,000. College Park, they're $150,000 to $250,000. Colonial Town, they're $250,000 and up. So you can get a good bargain. And don't just take it from me. The Orlando Business Journal also found the same thing. So while our housing sales actually were going down last year, the price, the median sale price was going up. So not many people are buying, but the prices are going up. It's a lot of really good, solid housing stock that we have. So we also have some very strong public-private partnerships. If you know anything about neighborhood revitalization, those public and private partnerships are key to getting things moving along. So we have my office, the Pine Hills Neighborhood Improvement District, which is a special district under Florida statute, just like, you know, downtown south and some of those areas. So our mission is mostly to stimulate economic revitalization in the area. And we are a part of Orange County government. We get our funding from Orange County government, and we've been around since 2011, working in the community to get these projects done. So some of the things that we do, business redevelopment, town center development. Our community went through a planning process many years ago and determined that they wanted to have a town center. So the intersection of Silver Star and Pine Hills Road, which is right here, they have decided that that will be our town center. So we've been diligently working to create a town center in that area. We'll be creating a gateway feature, something to give a sense of arrival once you arrive in the Pine Hills. And we've been really working to get rid of all of the graffiti and the and all of the litter. We've been doing anti-litter campaigns because one of the things that we kept hearing was that Pine Hills is so dirty. Nobody wants to open business in a place that's full of litter. So we hire somebody that goes out and cleans up the roads four times a week. We started a behavioral change campaign, asking people to clean up, green up, and spruce up Pine Hills. That was our slogan. We work with Jason's office. They're the neighborhood pros, that's what I call them, the Neighborhood Preservation and Revitalization Office. And Jason's office gives out what's known as a bank grant. The bank grant stands for Business Assistance to Neighborhood Corridors. So businesses in our area can get $5,000 twice from Orange County for facade improvements. And that's up to $10,000 that many of the businesses in our area have taken advantage of. It's not just open to Pine Hills, it's open to many neighborhoods in Orlando, but Pine Hills by far is the biggest user. Our businesses really are savvy about taking advantage of the bank. We're also working with the Orange County's planning and zoning process to create a zoning overlay so that we can begin to limit some of those undesirable uses or some of the things that are overrepresented in our area, like pawn shops and places that like to store a lot of junk outside. We're just trying to curb all of those things through our zoning overlay. And we also are going to begin making a lot of bicycle and pedestrian safety improvement. I was surprised when I asked what you knew about Pine Hills, but like I said, you can get hit by a car. Because we had that happen a lot in our community. And so Orange County last year started a bicycle and pedestrian safety study, which recently concluded, and that safety study came up with some things that we can do to make our community safer. So we will be working with Orange County's Transportation Planning, Traffic Engineering Department divisions to make our community safer for pedestrians as well as bicyclists and also wheelchairs, believe it or not. We have a lot of people that traverse Pine Hills Road and Silver Star Road in wheelchairs. So this is Pine Hills Neighborhood Improvement District boundaries. You can see that we take up most of Pine Hills Road between West Colonial and Silver Star, as well as Silver Star Road between Hiawassee and Pine Hills Road. Those are considered our district boundaries, and we do a lot of our work within those boundaries, but Pine Hills is so much larger than the Neighborhood Improvement District. We have a lot of infrastructure investment coming to Pine Hills, and that's always a good sign. So another good bone. Over $7 million in ongoing and planned improvements Orange County, the utilities, that those will be going into things like roads and sidewalks, upgraded street lighting, additional street lighting. We heard that Pine Hills is too dark at night, so more street lighting as well as converting a lot of the existing street lights to LED. Parks and Recreation will be making some improvements to Barnett Park, as well as additional programs and services that will be offered through Orange County in the Pine Hills area. So these are just some of our partnerships. We have engaged stakeholders, LYNX, who's here with us today, and as always, anywhere we go, we see Jeff. We have the Pine Hills Safe Neighborhood Partnership, with a group of residents that have been working with Jason's office for 20 years, doing a variety of safety projects. They get grants every year from Orange County to implement a variety of safety projects, including off-duty deputies patrolling the community, safety fairs and events. We work with the West Orange Chamber, the Pine Hills Community Council, the Sheriff's Office, even the local radio station. Pine Hills has its own radio station. It only broadcasts 10 miles, but it's you know, our community resource, so they're a partner. So we have all of these engaged stakeholders. You can see these are some of the engaged stakeholders. These are business owners that have taken advantage of Jason's grant or just through their own, you know, desire to improve the community have done these amazing renovations. This is a Caribbean restaurant that went through the bank program, and they also won a beautification award. Again, this is another one, an electrician who took that old building where Jason actually stood in it and could look up and see the sky, could look down at the dirt floors. This building had been derelict for a long time, and this owner, through the bank grant, renovated it, and he operates a very successful electrical company out of that building, and they also won our beautification award. And this is an old building that was repurposed into a daycare. No bank grant. This was another owner who took this corner and we had this eyesore right at the intersection where we want to do our commercial town center. And he, with his own family, turned it into this beautiful, it's called RC store. It's a little store, there's a little restaurant in there, you can get gas. It's really like a little neighborhood market and gas station. And he also won our commission work with an effort to make our community look better. We want to recognize them. So we have lots of business owners in that community that buy into that and really make a difference. And this is a tremendous transformation. And on the other corner, just opposite to that, is a $75 million renovation, rebuild really, of Evans High School. It's a beautiful facility if you've never had the opportunity to go. Give me a call, I'll be happy to give you a tour of that or anywhere in Pine Hills so you can see that sometimes what you see and hear on TV or by word of mouth is not always accurate. So we have that. This was the Pine Hills, this was updated, the Pine Hills Marketplace. So we also have on Silver Pine Shopping Center, which just did a $1 million renovation, and they're right on Silver Star in our town center area. So you can see how this went from space age to new age. Phenomenal transformation. We also have been trying to combat these eyesores, these posters that people go out in the middle of the dead of night, we can never catch them, they must be invisible, and they put these posters all over the poles and the traffic boxes. Well, we started to clean the boxes, paint the boxes and the poles, put artwork on the boxes, and then coat them with something called Biotrades. Biotrades is this super duper space age cold coating that nothing sticks to. No glue, no tape. If somebody were to spray paint it, all we need is a cloth and water, and we can just wipe it off. So it's really like this really amazing space age coating that we've been putting on our boxes. This is one of the guys that's been coating the boxes. This is our cleanup guy. They work really hard to keep Pine Hills clean. So you can see through those before and after, so they make a big difference. Pine Hills has big plans. I have brought lots of our plans that we've created over the years, planning documents, marketing analysis, studies, annual reports. So there's a lot of accountability in what we've been doing over the years. And if you're interested in finding out more about what our long-term plans are, what we've done in the past, feel free to go onto our website. All of these documents are on our website. But Pine Hills has big plans. One of them is our town center. So this is the area that we've identified as our town center, the red star, right at the heart of Silver Star and Pine Hills Road. You can see the Evans High School. See the Silver Pine Shopping Center, which just got a big remodel, and we hope that in the next 2 to 3 years we'll have our gateway in, and it'll be a completely different feel to the heart of Pine Hills. This is a rendering of what we hope our gateway project will look like. It will include signage letting you know that you have arrived in the neighborhood of Pine Hills, as well as some safety measures and some landscaping, everything to give it that excitement, like, oh, we've arrived at this really cool place called Pine Hills. And we have a big bang project. Transit-centric residents have piqued the interest of LYNX, who has decided to do a big project in our community. And that's what Jeff is here to talk about, because this is our big bang project. If you familiar with downtown South, you know, we've heard, I've heard Tom Kohler give presentations where he has said that downtown South renovation was stimulated by a Big Bang project, and that was Target. Until that Target project started coming out of the ground, they had a hard time getting buy-in and people interested. Well, in Pine Hills, we have the highest LYNX ridership. You know, we have many walkers and cyclists as well as wheelchairs. So with that in mind, I'm going to turn it over to Jeff Reine, who's with LYNX, and he's going to tell you about our Big Bang project, a multi-million dollar project that we're really excited about coming to our neighborhood.
LYNX and Orange County have got a really good working relationship. So one misconception some people think about LYNX is that we are a private company, which we are not. LYNX is actually an acronym for absolutely nothing. 20 plus years ago, we were still known as the Central Florida Regional Transportation Authority, which is a big mouthful. And it does not come easy off the tongue. So we did a naming and back then, and so it came up LYNX. We got our notoriety. If you remember where our old LYNX station was, which is where the current station number one is downtown, we painted the building pink. And shortly thereafter, we had instant brand name recognition. So when we paint the building downtown Orlando, LYNX paint, you get noticed. So we are actually established by state statute, like every transit authority in the state. Where we're a little bit different, like your Miami-Dades and your Jacksonville and JKA, which is a consolidated city-county government, we have got four major funding partners. So you'll see where our total operating budget is up there to around $133 million. Half of that comes from our locals, so that's Orange, Seminole, Osceola, and the city of Orlando, and Orange County is the lion's share of our funding partner because they actually end up with the most service. So it's tied in with the level of service that you get is how we can fill it. So the rest of it's made up pretty even, Steven, between fares. So when you're hitting about 30%, we call it fare box recovery, somebody putting a point in there, you're doing pretty good as a transit agency if you can get a 25 to 30% of your service being paid for by fares. The rest of our operating budget is made up from DOT and then some federal dollars as well. Capital, so some people will say, well, back in 2008 when we had the recession, we did cut back service, but we were still doing projects. Two different pots of money. We use the Federal Transit Administration, which is where a lot of our construction projects that I think come from. So, and all 5307 means that's the place in the Federal Register where all 8,425 pages of rules and regulations, if I'm exaggerating, that I have to abide by are. So that's where sometimes you'll see we're not expanding service necessarily, but we've got federal dollars to do projects. So give you a little bit of history. And where the money from this grant actually came from was a portion is coming from those $5307, and then about 3 years ago, we decided that one of our biggest costs was the driver, the bus. And we've got places, instead of putting two buses out, if you've got volume, what we do up in Pine Hills, you can put a 60-foot bus in. And those buses are not cheap. I mean, does anybody have an idea of how much a bus costs? Take a step.
$1 million.
You're at $300,000.
Half a million.
So,
you don't get to it. Yeah, I know you.
But the buses you see going by here are right around $500,000 to $550,000. An articulated bus can run with about $850,000. So we put in to get roughly 10 of the 60-foot buses, and we threw on the end of it that we wanted $1 million to support this project, not for the full budget, without having any environmental done that said every 5 years and going to use it. Orange County is kind enough to give us about $500,000. LYNX actually got into the property acquisition business. Typically, we find the good graces of folks, and that we're trying to hear a little bit of our history, why we ended up where we are. So, in 2011, the Park Promenade, which is Hiawassee and the Silver Star, it used to be a Kmart, then a Max Mart, then a J Mart, and then a Max Mart, is what it is now. So, when J Mart was looking to sell, we relied on his good graces for years. We weren't paying a lease fee, so he said goodbye. We ended up pulling our service out of his shopping center and then transferring the buses on all four corners of Iowa City Silver Star. So close to 2,000 people a day transferring on all four corners wasn't producing. So we had the same, right before the charrette that for the Pine Hills Town Center came, we were looking at the site selection process to figure out where to put this. And we actually ended up coming up with the same area that the charrette had come up with, which would be actually just west of the intersection of Pine Hills and Silver Star. I'll show that to you. So in 2014, like I said, we got that maximum opportunity grant to go towards this. Since I use federal dollars, I have to do an environmental screen, so we did that in 2015. Orange County worked with us to get this rezoned and our land exchange to allow for a transit center to go in. Last year, we ended up purchasing the property, and currently we're undergoing 15% design on this. I'll get into that in just a little bit. So we hope to be done with final engineering and design, ready to go out to bid in January of this coming year. So here's your Pine Hills Road, Silver Star Road, and then we're actually, here's Belco Road, actually comes here from Pine Hills, comes back around to Silver Star Road. Mentioning what Michelle was talking about, just south of here, doesn't show up in this area, is where the Pine Hills Trail currently comes up and dead ends the map at Silver Star Road. There is a crosswalk there. We're actually going to be extending, I'll show it to you in a later slide, the trail. The Pine Hills Pedestrian Study has identified putting a 10-foot shared use path on the east side of Pine Hills Road, so we'll be incorporating that trail. The only part we did buy is there's the Urban League's got a building to the north. If that's getting a little sticky, if I go try and buy a building, I'm really not going to use. So we didn't buy the building. We are going to be working with them because we're going to impact their truck. So we have to move their driveway to the parking spot. So we will be working with them. So this will give you an idea. One of the things that LYNX is in the process of doing, and you can go to lynxforward.com for that, we are looking at a whole what's called route optimization study. So what I always tell people that are familiar with Pine Hills, those route numbers don't match up with what's out there now. We're looking at the best way to deliver service. So places like Pine Hills, we can take the peanut butter.
I can't hear you over here.
Is that better?
That's helpful. Okay. Thank you.
I'll project it. Thank you. So one of the things we're looking at with our route optimization study, how do we spread the peanut butter? That's how you like to use that analogy. We can spread it everywhere and give everybody a 15-minute service, or give everybody a 40-foot bus. But there's places where that doesn't make sense. I use where I live up in Seminole County as a spot where it doesn't make sense. We run a 40-foot bus out to very good use at the end of, if you go out 46, like you're heading towards I-95, before you get into the middle of nowhere, there's 415, which goes up to New Smyrna Beach. There's a health clinic out there, very good use. But does it make sense to run a 40-foot bus out there? Not necessarily. So our route optimization is showing in that area, we replace it with what we call neighborhood circulator. Before we partner, one of the things we're looking at is how we can partner with the Ubers and Lyfts of the world and transition the trips there. So this will be what our long-term routing is going to be looking at going in there as well. So we're tying that in with this as well. So we have two-stage design process. It's facility programming concept design that we're in now, and then phase two will be preliminary final design. So one of the things that we changed was kind of the way we did public involvement. LYNX would typically go out and use our standard design and say, here's what we're doing. Love it, hate it. That's what we would do. Here, we fully involved the community. We went in with no preconceived notions of what this was going to look like. We said to the community, we truly want to know what you want it to be, what kind of things you want to see at this transfer center. So we had some very basic requirements. I needed the ability for the 8 to 10 bus bays for future growth. We needed to, of course, have some Americans with Disabilities Act accessibility, lighting and wayfinding, and then we needed to have some sort of protection, shelters, and then some landscaping. So right now our base level budget, because I'm greedy and like to ask the federal government for our money, is $3 million. We're getting back our final, we should have a cost estimate, preliminary cost estimate in the next 2 weeks. I have a feeling that's going to go up some because we're going to be doing some major adjustments to Belco Road. So we've got the ability to put in up to 50,000 square feet. We're going to be working closely with our partners on this project to figure out how we can best do that. One of the things is even though we've got the ability to do that 50,000 square foot building, we may not be the ones putting that in because the base cost for a building works out to about us. The low end is $1.5 million, they say, per floor. So one of the things we may be looking at is in private-public partnership. One of the things my CEO's tasked us with. Here's some of the community uses that the community has said they wanted. When we reached out, we actually spent 3 different days out with the Evans High School students as well. So we wanted their input since one of the heaviest users of our transit system. And so they wanted to see an educational component Valencia. I just actually had a conversation right before I came to this meeting that I said, well, we may bid on that. We may be able to help you out with their, they've leased space. It's not something LYNX has gotten into. So it's a little bit of a new frontier for us of using a transfer center for some other use just besides our buses. So like I said, we've got the ability to put in that 50,000 square feet. We're looking at doing some art and cultural elements. And then we've got access to the site for community events, of course our buses, wheelchair cyclists with the trail. And then we're looking at having some sustainable elements, solar. When I show you the concept design that we've gotten to this point on, we're looking at the ability to put a rain garden in. Per project schedule, we started roughly in January. If you are here, should be moving out just a little bit. But right now we've had, you'll see on there, we are not really having that many bi-weekly meetings with my consultant. Just you put them on there. But you'll see that we've got community design workshops. We just had one in April. Continuous outreach with our funding partners and our other partners on this project. And then we do have project steering committees. We've got four of those, that project steering committee, some of those partners that Michelle mentioned earlier, Pine Hills Safe Neighborhoods, Pine Hills NID, Pine Hills Community Council, Duke Energy, DOT, all of our friends at the various offices in Orange County are all sitting at the table giving us input on that. And then right before that meeting, we have one with the term incentives. So one of the things is we did do a public participation for the piece of this, and we had some vision boards up. And the big thing that came up, and I did caution them when they came up with these colors, primary colors as primary colors on a building, don't usually fare too well in Florida, so we could look at those as accent colors, but those tie nicely though when you go look at the Pine Hills logo. Those colors came out because that's what's in the logo, so we'll make sure we incorporate that. But one of the things that came out, one thing we told them is it may not be this exact brick, that exact one. It was to get an idea of what type of look they were looking for, and the one thing that was coming out of this was something modern. We did actually have on one of the vision boards the old Amtrak station in downtown, and that got a resounding, I think, like, every single person that was there could have stood around and say, absolutely not. So they're looking for some clean lines, they're looking for something modern. So that's one of the things that came out of our participation. We had it on a Saturday, because one of the things, last thing I wanted to do was have a community meeting that was going to show up. So one of the things they told us is fine, have it on a Saturday with teams. So we had it from 10 to 2, we found it. So, and we've got, so then, like I said, here's some more results of that, just in terms of, like I said, that modern look. And so what's come out of this, and so when we did our design charrette, what came out of this was what you see here. So orientate yourself north is this way, so Pine Hills Road is here on the south, or on the bottom of the screen here. And then Silver Star, of course, is right there. So what we're looking at, this has been slightly adjusted since this, because we just met with Duke Energy. So one of the things we're looking at is some community activity space on the power line easement. That may shrink a little to get some more parking in for the building. We're looking at, one of the things that we talked to the community about is they would like to have some sort of community activities. They're not necessarily community meeting space. The one thing that's nice about Pine Hills between Evans High School, letting us use their facility, we've got the Jennings Community Center, and then there's the Cultural Center that's going in, and then we've also got partners out there like Wellcare that let people use their. There's a lot of community meeting space, but one of the things there's not is something to have community activities. So we're looking at putting previous painters in there. We could have food trucks. We could have, you know, mobile medical clinics. We could have a farmer's market and all that type of stuff. One of the things you'll see, if you get really close, you can see. We do have provisions in there for Uber and Lyft. We actually have provisions in there for LYNX's neighbor LYNX, our neighborhood circulator, and for access LYNX with the stable. So, and then we do have the footprint there. Like I said, we've got the ability to go up to 50,000 square foot. Depending what comes up, we're going to be having some different conversations with Orange County about parking maximums instead of minimums. I'm just looking at that general direction. I'm not looking at Jason per se. But we are looking, though, that's one of the conversations literally I just had with my consultant now, is that with what we kind of can't do in that power line easement, to reduce the amount of parking spaces we can put in. So we're going to be looking at having that discussion with them, which may then, like I said, result in what we could end up putting in that building. So one of the things that came out is they just didn't want individual bus shelters sitting like in some of our transfer centers have. They want a canopy covering everything. So we've got that shown here. The trail will be integrated along the east side of the transfer center here, and then we'll do our tie-in. We'll actually extend the trail along on the north side of Belco Road, so that way it'll hook up with the larger trail going in on the east side of Pine Hills Road. So with that, I will turn it back over to you.
So you can see what an amazing car. Frontier where people feel, you know, safe and secure and invested. investing and moving and becoming a part of the community. We got our cool history. We got location, location, location. Lots of commercial corridor. We have connected road networks. Lots of density and diversity. We have awesome amenities. We have our quirky landmarks like Elvis. You know, we have our affordable housing stock, public-private partnerships, infrastructure investment, engaged stakeholders. We have our master plans, and we have a transit-oriented community. This community is already predisposed to riding the bus and walking and biking, whereas in some communities, you have to go in and beg them to do that. They already do it in the high-risk community, so we are very proud of what we've accomplished. We're very proud of our residents, and if you're interested in joining us and becoming one of those mini cultures working towards our bright future, please feel free to reach out to me. If you need to know more about what Jeff has going on, please feel free to reach out to us. We're always more than happy to tell you all the great things that are going on in Pine Hills. Thank you.
Two things. One is, because I go to a lot of the Pine Hills Community Council meetings, I've got to tell you, I go to a lot of community meetings. I mean, at their monthly meetings, we only have 75 to 100 people consistently. And I'm talking about both people who are long-time residents who've been here since the 60s. What's the guy from the parties, owns the parties up there? As well as new people who have come there. So it's very interesting to hear a lot of things about Pine Hills. But there are a lot of other neighborhoods that are more affluent than Pine Hills. You go there, and there are like five people at the meeting, so people are very, very engaged in that. But what are the prospects in terms of every now and then people talk about incorporating it as a city? How realistic is that, or is that more likely to happen as some of these things kind of come into play?
That is not actually a topic that comes up a lot at any of the meetings that we go to. I think we all in Pine Hills that in order to incorporate, we have to have a really steady, prolific tax base that we don't have, and the process of becoming a new city is very cumbersome. And I don't think that there's a lot of political will as well as residential will to move in that direction. You know, right now, we have a very good relationship there. You know, historically, there have been some mistrust between Pine Hills and government, but we have moved away from that. And I think that for the most part, people that live and work in Pine Hills are working really well with all the various partnerships and getting accomplished what they need to get accomplished without having to go that cumbersome route of becoming incorporated. But if we did, we'd be the second largest Orange County. Thank you, Governor. Yes?
You never bring up MERS transportation. We always talk about Uber and Lyft, and MERS is a pretty big contributor. Something like a transportation hub.
So from a transit, and that's a really good question, from a transit standpoint, LYNX is required if anybody, and we've got actually a good working relationship with MERS, because I actually sat on a panel, this was some years ago, at the Orange County Convention Center. It was actually a reporter in the audience that asked me, so do you two angel? And I was literally sitting next to the government affairs person. I said, absolutely not, we had just awarded them a contract for bus service. So we're required by our federal rules, if MERS comes to us and wants to take over every single one of our profitable routes, if we've got some routes that are really high performance, like 125, we by law have to turn it over. So we've got a good relationship with them. We actually, for a while, the route's going away now because Subrail Phase 2 is coming in. We had a route going from the San Lake Subrail Station down to Sydney, and we actually found it more conducive for us to have MERS run that service for us. The IRI trolley used to be actually two lanes bus routes. The MERS came to IRI and said we can give you a better rate. They did. Now when gas prices went to $4 a gallon, they tried to get back to us again. Very much. So we try to build a relationship with MERS. I mean, we've got the ability. I won't use this Pine Hills example as an example, but I'll use one down in Kissimmee. Reine actually uses our transfer center down at Kissimmee Intermodal Center. We built that in advance of Subrail Phase 2 because we needed it whether Subrail happened or not. So we've got good working relationships with private entities and private companies. So right now, though, one of the things, like I said, but to your point, though, like the Uber's and Lyft's, one of the things, though, that we're focusing on are places that may, or we just